So I believe we're living through a very exciting time because many governments, including of course Norway's, are thinking about how to achieve a particular type of growth, not just economic growth for growth's sake. So we hear a lot about smart innovation-led growth, we hear about inclusive growth, and of course sustainable growth. And the real question is, what kind of framework do policymakers actually require in order to tilt the direction of growth towards smart, inclusive, sustainable growth? And unfortunately, what we usually hear is that policymakers shouldn't direct anything. They should simply level the playing field, and then somehow the market will decide which direction, if you want, growth goes into, what kind of markets, what kind of technologies and sectors. And so it's very interesting for a country like Norway, which is really trying to think about, if you want, the green transformation of the economy, is to reflect on what we know about previous revolutions, whether it was the internet revolution, the biotech revolution, the nanotechnology revolution, and the host of different types of policy instruments that were required in order for those directions to occur. And so what my work has done really is to try to debunk some of the usual ways we think about this. So again, policy is just leveling the playing field as simply fixing market failures, as simply creating the conditions and de-risking and deleveraging the private sector, and then somehow these great things will happen. And so what I talk about is, instead of fixing market failures, we should actively create and shape markets, and that this requires a very different type of both economic theory, but especially policy framework for policymakers, if you want to then understand how to tackle these big challenges. And so first of all, if we look, for example, at the IT revolution, what we see was this very active role of public policy throughout the entire chain of innovation, from basic research, applied research, and even the funding of the companies themselves, those few innovative companies that even want to engage with such challenges. And this is important because, again, coming back to the market failure framework, that framework teaches us that, yes, of course, you need public intervention, but only when you have very, very specific circumstances. For example, when you have basic research, basic science, which is a public good, which has all sorts of spillovers, so you have very little private investment in basic research and, you know, blue sky science, and so government must fix that problem, intervene, and invest in basic research. And of course, that's hugely important. Many countries don't do that enough. However, again, coming back to the whole IT revolution, had government simply focused on the basic science, we would not have actually gotten all these, you know, great innovations, whether we're talking about the personal computer itself, the things inside the personal computer, so the chip, the internet, etc. So these kinds of interventions required an active, visible hand across that whole chain, including applied research, including early stage financing of companies, and especially nurturing the feedback between all these different components. So specific institutions, which would be public institutions, which actually created these dynamic linkages and feedback effects between these different stages. The other point is that these different agencies that were required, and I'm thinking here mainly about places like Silicon Valley, because unfortunately that area of the world is always used as a symbol of what everyone else should copy, and yet we haven't learned really what happened there. So this is the only reason I focus so much on Silicon Valley. What actually we had there was a host of lots of different public organizations, not just one big ministry thinking what to do top down across innovation. No? So this decentralized network of different public organizations was absolutely fundamental. And on top of that, they were mission oriented. They themselves didn't see their role as simply fixing a little problem here or there. If you look at their websites, whether it's DARPA, which was important for the internet, NASA, of course, which, you know, invested so much in space research, but alongside many different sectors, including textiles, ARPA-E, which today is trying to emulate what DARPA did in the Department of Defense, but in the Department of Energy. If you just look at their websites, they really talk about their role as being important for actively creating a new landscape, not just fixing an existing one. And another really important point is that the investments that we see that these organizations made was direct. It wasn't indirect. And by indirect, I mean through different types of, say, tax credits, right? There's all sorts of tax incentives that one might think about, whether it's around R&D or patents. Those might be important, But in fact, we know that they only really have an effect when they are complementing these much more direct investments, which would be investing, again, directly in basic research, in applied areas, specific problems, or directly in companies. So this whole issue that we have out there, which we have policymakers scared of picking winners and being told not to pick winners, is a false dilemma. Everything behind the iPhone that makes the iPhone smart and not stupid and idiotic was picked. It was chosen, right? So the internet was chosen, GPS was chosen, touchscreen display was chosen, the Siri voice activated system. These were specific technologies or even general areas that were chosen by different public agencies. And even the companies themselves were chosen. So Apple got a very large loan from the SBIC program. But the bigger program called SBIR, Small Business Innovation Research Program, over time has actually given much more high-risk finance to early stage development inside companies than the whole private sector, sorry, private venture capital sector. And this again is something we pretend is not there because this required choosing companies. And many of these companies fail. Or many of the projects that the companies are funded to, you know, go after will fail. But this is normal. Innovation is extremely uncertain. Most R&D projects fail. We know this and we accept it when we're talking about entrepreneurs or the venture capital sector. As soon as government screws up, we say, oh, you're stupid government, what are you doing? You know, why are you picking winners? Of course you can't do that. You're just a bunch of stupid bureaucrats. and that's a really false dilemma because if we want the kind of strategic government which has existed in the US, and I would argue does exist or is emerging today in China, has existed in different countries, in Scandinavia, I would say, especially Denmark, has had very interesting types of public agencies making these direct investments and really benefiting, the economy's really benefited from that, then we have to welcome failure. When we do look at green around the world, and I'm currently doing quite a bit of research on the emergence of the green economy, mainly at the technological level, what we see is exactly what we saw with biotech and the internet, is that the highest risk areas, especially those areas with high capital intensity, are basically devoid of private capital. We have mainly public sector organizations, including big public banks, and there's about four of them, the German Public Bank, the Chinese Public Bank, the Brazilian and the European Investment Bank, which are really taking the lead role in some of the highest risk parts of the deployment and diffusion part of the innovation process. And that's all fine. But the problem is that unless we admit it, unless we say, look, there's, you know, this new landscape that has to be created, there's different levels of risk, and of course we need, you know, the public sector to be leading in the difficult bit, which, by the way, Bill Gates says very clearly. He says the private sector will never do it. We need an active public sector to engage with the green revolution as they did with the IT revolution. Because we don't admit it, we end up relying too much on different types of incentive schemes and think that all we need maybe is either a carbon tax or different types of incentives and somehow all this great stuff will occur. On top of that, we have, of course, massive austerity around the world still inside public organizations, which are no longer feeling the kind of courage to take a leading role in green as they took. And so when we think of the green transformation in a country like Norway, we really need to ask very concrete questions. You know, the first being, do we want to choose green as a direction? If so, what does that mean? Does it just mean financing some R&D here and there and doing some tax incentives? No, it really requires getting a sense of green as a direction, but also across that entire innovation chain, even the deployment and the diffusion stage. Because if we go back to technological revolutions around, say, mass production, not only did they require the supply side investments, they also required bold policies that then played a demand pull innovation. For example, suburbanization ended up allowing mass production to be fully diffused and deployed throughout the economy. So green could also become a new direction through which the IT revolution becomes fully deployed and diffused. So green is not only about renewable energy, and there we must make sure it's a portfolio of different renewable energy technologies, but it can also become a new direction for the IT revolution, which is widely recognized as not having had yet the full effect it could have. So a new direction for IT, just like suburbanization provided a direction for mass production. But we also, you know, there's a big sovereign wealth fund, of course, in Norway. And there should be, if you want, more pressure on funds like that, which obviously are benefiting from past resources, to actually be reinvesting in the new resources. In fact, unfortunately, there's quite a bias in many of these sovereign wealth funds around the world and still investing in areas like real estate or different easier areas. And there's, you know, this should be part of the deal. When I talk about deals, like the one that got Bell Labs to be born out of AT&T, there could be deals between, you know, both government and business where a big wealth fund, which, you know, is in the public hands, like the Norwegian one, becomes a co-investor alongside some of the companies that have benefited from these, you know, public investments into the new future, if you want, green areas. So that's the whole question around directionality, which we have to, you know, pick green as a direction and ask ourselves, what does that mean? Two, we need to build the organizations in the public sector, which are able to welcome this explorative process I mentioned in the beginning. It cannot be top down just through one organization, you know, a multitude of different organizations which together interact and welcome the trial and error process. Three, we need actually ways to measure the outcome of these investments. So it's no good to have all these great, you know, public institutions making great investments and then judging them, evaluating them, assessing them with old static cost-benefit criteria. Tesla received a $465 million in a guaranteed loan, very successful from the government. Solyndra received $500 million, a complete failure. Now, setting this up as a portfolio might have been more intelligent for the government, right? So actually retaining some equity directly, not thinking, you know, in terms of indirect tax return, direct equity in a company like Tesla for a period at least, so that some of the upside could come back to the same public agency that funded the Solyndra, which then the Solyndra company, which went bankrupt. So some of the upside can be used to fund the downside and the next round of investment. So this is the point. Once we admit that government isn't just spending and regulating and administering and de-risking, but actually investing, and in fact being a lead investor, a lead risk taker, then perhaps they should wisen up a bit and actually formulate these investments like a portfolio and make sure they get some of the return from the upside. I also think that currently there is a bit of confusion in some countries, including Norway, on the role of universities and how to prove that universities are producing value. In Holland, they call this valorization. No? So this obsession with showing commercialization, showing economic value is crazy. I always compare this to sex, which I probably shouldn't, but it's useful because when people of whatever, you know, man or woman have problems in their sex life, if they obsess too much about it, it's just not going to happen, right? So you should just relax and not focus on the outcome, but just relax. And this is one of the lessons we learn actually from the technological revolutions. When there was a bit more relaxation and the attention was on the mission, on the vision to do something pretty crazy, not to worry right away for the economic value and the commercialization. So going to the moon or, you know, financing a whole new sector like biotech or nanotech, then the commercialization happened and it happened really well. When you start obsessing on commercialization, it doesn't happen. and I think that's extremely important also because this focus on having to prove the economic value of any public investment in a short period basically kills that public investment, and then we see it's a failure, and then we want to cut it even more. So it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. Universities have always been important in financing and thinking about this innovation process, especially, of course, the basic research has almost always come out of mainly universities. But there's a false dilemma between basic and applied. Some of the biggest challenges, what I mean by mission-oriented, is when you think sort of in terms of big problems, you need both basic and applied, and in fact, they feed off of each other quite a bit. That doesn't mean that you always have to, you know, feed off of each other. There should be often blue sky just for the sake of blue sky. It cannot always interact with applied, but by positioning it as one or the other, it often creates quite a static debate. And I think one of the interesting things about thinking, not in terms of sectors, you know, the key sectors, the top sectors, or whatever these different types of industrial policies think about, but different types of big problems that require new types of thinking in all sorts of fields, and by the way, not just the hard sciences, also the social sciences, this, I think, is a more useful way than to think that in order to rebalance economies, you need, you know, to think about the aerospace, automotive, financial services, creative sector, renewable energy. of course, choices have to be made along the sectoral lines too, but what we really require is new ways to think about the problems and how to engage universities in that process. The obsession around commercialization has also hurt universities in terms of having to constantly prove the worth of their science. I think that's not very useful. So because Norway is so embedded in a particular, if you want, you know, into resource extraction, and the economy is so biased towards that area, and in a moment where the price of oil is falling as it is, you know, this really should be, if you want, seen as a crisis that creates an opportunity, as opposed to just having fear and if you want, regret that investments weren't made in the past. They should really be thinking how to structure future investments in order to rebalance the economy in a multitude of different directions and get it out of its current, if you want, bias. But that really requires thinking along these four areas that I mentioned, which are directionality, assessment, you know, how do we actually assess these directions that we're going to choose, building the organizations which can co-invest alongside the private sector and welcome this trial and error process and the sharing of risks of rewards. Just saying Norway should invest all of a sudden in more pharmaceutical companies or the creative sector without really thinking through these fundamental processes, which are really kind of cross-cutting across any area that becomes invested in, I think would, you know, be a mistake. Because say that the economy then, you know, makes the choice to become a leader in, you know, life sciences, well, that, you know, that too at one point will face, if you want, constraints. So it's really, I think, about also keeping options open, investing in a multitude of different ways that create different pathways, which then can be analyzed as the economy moves. But again, the mechanisms through which we assess the directions that economy is taking really require us to have a more dynamic understanding of transformation. And so this market shaping, market creating process, not a market fixing one. And at least from my side, that's what I've been focusing on more, rather than telling economies, you know, what to invest in or what new sectors, what, you know, artificial intelligence or all those new areas. But, you know, what is important is, if you want, general purpose technologies, which can actually really dynamize and catalyze growth across many different sectors. Those are surely always very important to be thinking about, because it means you're not just focusing on a sector, but on investments which can transform the way that many different sectors produce, distribute, and then how people consume. So I see Germany's Energiewende policy in that light. I really see it as a complete transformation of the entire economy. It's not green in terms of renewable energy. They are greening all their sectors. And so we're often presented with manufacturing versus services. But in fact, Denmark, I think, is fascinating because it's a small country, but precisely because it really understood that, you know, it's not either basic research or having policies downstream to, you know, get people to buy certain kinds of cars. But they really thought about this in this mission-oriented way that I was talking about. They've become the number one provider of high-tech services to China's green economy, and China's spending $1.7 trillion on green. So, you know, pretty smart for a small country to put itself in that position. But that obviously required lots of changes to occur. We often think that, you know, countries can only change incrementally in very small steps. If you look at the history of Singapore, the history of Finland, which was one of the least innovative countries in the world before the 1980s, these massive steps occurred, big radical changes occurred as outcomes of policies. Policies were chosen to transform economies, and then of course business had a very important role, but business often follows, which doesn't mean it's bad or good, it's simply a fact. There's very few sectors where business didn't follow government's lead. Again, Bill Gates is so clear about this. He says, government must lead in green as government led in IT. He even goes farther. He says the private sector is inept. So he's allowed to say that. I'm not allowed to say that. But you know, this just means, you know, getting into a completely different policy framework instead of just incentivizing, de-risking, to really kind of lead the way. But the way to lead the way can only be done through actual organizations. It's not a ministerial decision top down. The president or the prime minister decides. It has to be done through this network of different public agencies across that entire space. Universities are absolutely fundamental, should be allowed to do their blue sky research. But we also need these intermediary institutions, but also have a real hold of the entire direction, as opposed to just thinking the market will decide the direction. The market has never, ever decided anything that's interesting. And markets are outcomes. Markets don't exist. There's nothing, you know, what's the market? The market is an outcome of interactions between different types of public and private sector actors. And again, also civil society putting pressure on these actors. So what we should think about in terms of policy is these interactions. What are the healthiest interactions between the actors that will get us the market outcomes we want? Instead of thinking as the market is out there, which some people hype it up in the positive sense, you know, the market is great, we need the state to step back, or others hype it up in the negative sense, the market, you know, it's bad because it creates short-termism. That's not true. Just look at any sector. In telecoms, we have some very short-term companies reinvesting most of their profits in, you know, things like share buybacks, and other ones like Ericsson and Huawei, no share buybacks, being very healthy, reinvesting their profits back into production. These are choices that have to be made in private sector institutions, as well as there's choices in public sector institutions. And as soon as we change the emphasis on these choices, what kind of actors, you know, mission-oriented versus non-mission-oriented public agencies, financialized versus non-financialized private sector, corporate governance matters, governance of public institutions matter, that's what we should be thinking about. And without those changes, you won't get any transformation, whether it's green, blue, or pink.